So coming to the part where thrombolysis, how much are we thrombolyzing the patients with, and where are the trends of thrombolysis? By the year of 2006, there was a very nice study published in Neurology, the Basic Project. They studied more than 5,000 patients, and they found out that there were around, they studied 5,277 patients of acute ischemic stroke, and they found out TPA use was steady around 2% in the beginning till the year of 2006. But after the year of 2006, we have been having increasing trend of the thrombolysis up to around 11% in the subsequent years. This diagram, it shows beautifully that beyond 2006 and into the coming years, the incidences where thrombolysis is being practiced is growing, and that is the need of the hour. Even the stroke units need to be set up where you can go on thrombolyzing as and when needed. So IV TPA for acute ischemic stroke, as we see, the times are changing, and what was anticipated to be revolutionary change, it has turned out to be an evolutionary change. And primary stroke centers and stroke care systems, they are giving proper stroke care to the patients these days. Now, what is the regimen? As we have discussed, the dose is 0.9 mg per kg. 10% of the bolus dose needs to be given immediately. Remaining 90% is given in the form of infusion over the next 1 hour. And patient needs to be in a stroke unit or stroke ICU with neurological assessment that is done every 15 minutes during the infusion of the IV TPA. Then you can reduce it to every 30 minutes for next 6 hours. Then every hour you should check till next 24 hours. If there's severe headache, acute hypertension, there's some form of nausea or vomiting that the patient is having, then it should be taken seriously and urgency should be looked into, because if you can't do good to the patient with thrombolysis, there should be no way that you can do any harm with intracranial bleed. So you should always be on your toes once you have thrombolyzed the patient. The regimen, one should delay the placement of the nasogastric tube, one should delay the bladder catheters or intra-arterial catheters at least for 24 hours once you have thrombolyzed the patient. Anticoagulants or antiplatelet should be delayed again for next 24 hours after the thrombolysis. And everybody needs to be available 24/7, neurosurgeon, neurologist, the staff nurses, ICU specialists, and a competent stroke unit is needed if you want to pull off a thrombolysis successfully. Now, given the dose of 0.9 mg per kg and the cost associated issues, Asians started to look into if we can reduce the dose so that we can have lesser hemorrhages and the cost might come down as well. So they studied the, there was Enchanted trial, they studied 0.6 mg per kg dose in patients, and they found out in the trial, even though the conclusion was that it was a non-inferiority trial, they almost had similar efficacy. The side effects were lesser given that it's a lower form of dose, but then there were a lot of caveats to it. Predominantly it was just the Asian study, and as the Disney movie Enchanted shows, that it's very tempting to see things the way you wish they were instead of how they are. So even though Enchanted trial did show that there was a non-inferiority trial, but it is not, it was limited to the Asian patients only, and all the RCTs later on suggest that 0.9 mg per kg is the dose that we should be using for the patients. So in the wake of this guidelines, 2018 we have ASA guidelines, which are very crisp and very relatable guidelines for thrombolysis. Now, in this, indications of IV TPA are by and large within 3 hours you can thrombolyze the patient if the age is more than 18 years, and regardless of the upper limit of the age, preferably it should be less than 75, but above that it would be sort of beyond the guideline. Severity, any severity of stroke may be thrombolyzed, but if it is in the range of mild, moderate form of stroke with the NIHS of 5 to 15, they would probably respond the best. Now, if you have exceeded 3 hours and it's into 3 to 4.5 hours, the ECAS 3 trial gives us that age less than 80, those with no history of prior stroke, those who are not on any oral anticoagulants or NIHS of less than 25, a stroke not involving more than 1/3 of MCA territory, they are good candidates for thrombolysis. Now, there are certain patients, let's say a patient is taking aspirin and he develops stroke as a monotherapy or polytherapy, should you thrombolyze or not? On the basis, there have been the evidence that the benefit of thrombolysis with altiplase outweighs the small increased risk of symptomatic ICH. So irrespective of patient being on aspirin, you can thrombolyze him. Now, those who has the patient having chronic kidney diseases, those who are on dialysis, it has been shown that even if they have APTT on the higher side, but the risk of hemorrhagic complications may increase. So you have to be very, very of thrombolyzing the patients with CKD. Now, cerebral microbleeds, very often, even if we have time with us, we do the MRI, we tend to find that there are multiple microbleeds in the patient along with the acute ischemic stroke. In such cases, they have given the guideline that if there are less than 10 microbleeds overall, you can go ahead with the thrombolysis. But if there are more than 10 microbleeds, then you need to weigh the options and you need to take your decision widely, because there may be increased risk of ICH. Now, patients who have sickle cell disease, they obviously can be thrombolyzed and it's been found to be beneficial. Those who have had LMWH in last 24 hours, in those patients, it's preferable to avoid doing the thrombolysis because they have very high risk of bleeding. So one should avoid if Clexin or low molecular weight heparin had been going on in last 24 hours, it should be avoided. Now, what are the contraindications other than this? The exclusion, if patient have had significant head trauma or patient has prior stroke within last 3 months, or symptoms suggest that there is subarachnoid hemorrhage, if there's history of arterial puncture at non-compressible site within previous 7 days, or if there's history of intracranial hemorrhage, intracranial aneurysms, neoplasms are contraindications. Recent intracranial or intraspinal surgery can put patient at the risk of developing bleed. Elevated blood pressure, which is in the malignant form, more than 200 systolic blood pressure of 185, which is not controllable, is a relative contraindication. Active internal bleeding, patient is having active bleeding due to any of the cause like bleeding dialysis with platelet of less than 1 lakh. Patient is having heparin, who has received heparin in last 48 hours and has APTT on the higher side. Or those who have been on anticoagulants with INR of more than 1.7 or PT of more than 15 seconds, they should be not thrombolyzed ideally. If you can avoid, it would be better. So contraindications other than this, if somebody is taking direct thrombin inhibitors and they have any of the lab parameters, they are deranged, then it should be avoided. Blood glucose concentration of less than 50 microgram per dl, which is like hypoglycemic patients, should be avoided from thrombolysis. And CT demonstrating there is multilobar infarct or hypodensity of more than 1/3 territory of MCA, they won't really do good with the thrombolysis, rather there's high risk of bleed in such patients. So the relative other forms of exclusion criteria, where if you could avoid, it would be better. Otherwise, you can still go ahead with the thrombolysis, but the risk would be on the higher side. If there's minor or rapidly improving stroke, if there's pregnancy associated with it, seizure at the onset of the stroke, because patient might be in postictal neurological impairment, major surgery which has been there in last 14 days, or this recent gastrointestinal or urinary tract hemorrhage in last 21 days, or recent acute myocardial infarction in last 3 months. These patients should be very cautiously evaluated for thrombolysis. So other modalities which were looked into by the AHA 2018 guidelines, they tried to look at tenecteplase, place, a dose of 0.4 mg per kg, single IV bolus, sounds very fascinating. They have started recommending it for very limited select patients. I'll come to that. And the use of sonothrombolysis, the ultrasound mechanism, is not recommended. Sonothrombolysis is out of practice. So chameleons and mimics, the stroke physician must balance at the onset, as we should know. There are two principles, the primum non tardere and primum non nauseare. We have to have the need for speed and we have to have the need for accuracy. And stroke mimics are the ones which look like stroke, but they are not strokes. Stroke chameleons are the ones which are actually stroke, but they present with something else. So before thrombolyzing, we need to rule them out. We had this patient who had a cortical venous thrombosis, but he presented like a stroke. So stroke mimics, there are different forms of stroke mimics, neurological like seizure disorders or the brain tumors, infectious conditions like encephalitis, brain abscesses. Metabolic are the most important ones, like severe hyponatremia, hypoglycemia, hepatic encephalopathy, or the ketotic states. Cardiovascular syncope often is considered as stroke. And then they found that seizure and syncope were the most important of the stroke mimickers that we had. even though it's a stroke mimic, still there had been a trial in which they studied the patient who were stroke mimickers, and they did a neuroimaging negative cerebral ischemia scan. They thrombolyzed the patient. They found out that there was no harm done to the patient. Rather, the clinical outcome was better eventually. That you should thrombolyze a stroke mimic. Okay, so what are the stroke chameleons? Stroke chameleons are basically something which doesn't present as stroke, but it is a stroke. So bilateral thalamic stroke can have global amnesia, a TIA can present with focal epilepsy, patient can have a cortical stroke which can present as a peripheral nerve lesion, patient can have bilateral occipital stroke and he may just be delirious or he may be confused. So stroke chameleons, they basically, they are the hidden forms of stroke where you need to apply your mind. With syncope, hypertensive emergencies and altered mental status, these are the different forms. Syncope, then suspected ACS, altered mental status, hypertensive emergencies, these are the common forms of stroke chameleons. Moving on, the last part of it, tenecty place, where we are. The third generation thrombolytic in stroke, tenecty place is a very lucrative option given the benefits that we have. It's a third generation tissue plasminogen activator. Basically, there are three site modifications at T, N and K, which gives it different form of molecular structure. It has the half-life, which is biphasic, and half-life elimination, initially it's 17 to 24 minutes, later on terminal it's 19 to 130 minutes. So now, in tenecty place, what advantages we have? 15-fold higher fibrin specificity, there's 80-fold reduced binding affinity to PAI1, and 4-fold prolonged plasma half-life, which are very important parameters. A single bolus administration, it helps big way, more effective in platelet-rich thrombi. It lacks the procoagulant effect, that's why it has maximum efficacy. There had been a major trial, NOTIS trial, to study the efficacy of tenecty place in stroke, and it's been very promising, but we are waiting for further better RCTs in the near future. So key advantages being better pharmacological profile that we have, fibrin specificity is more, lack of PAI inhibition, longer half-life, and it has better potency with lesser cost, almost one-third of the cost that of the ultiplace, and lesser wastage of the drug because the dose required is lesser. So near trials like Extend 1A and Test trial are the big trials which are going on to look into tenecty place for the acute stroke management. So now that we're moving into the newer era of stroke management, it's a very exciting area to be in. There are lots of good facilities available in the form of CT perfusion imaging. There have been major trials, Dawn and Diffuse trial. The Dawn trial was published on 4th Jan 2018, according to which thrombectomy when performed within 6 to 24 hours after stroke with a definite mismatch between deficit and infarct showed very good outcome. So patients, and there was another good trial, Diffuse 3 trial, January 24, 2018. It shows that thrombectomy for stroke at 6 to 16 hours with selection by perfusion imaging, the patients did really good. This is how basically the perfusion scan works. If we have a patient who had a volume of ischemic score infarct, which is roughly around 23 ml in this patient, this purple area, this patient has the penumbra of around 128 ml, which is a very large chunk of it and which is salvageable. So this is the amount of brain tissue that you can salvage if you act, and that's why it's important to demonstrate this with hypoperfusion scan, and if you have the time, you can still get the embolectomy done. With this, I'd like to finish it. Thank you, everyone.